It's what's funny is it, the church prayer list is always like a litmus test whenever, you know, we pray through it to give you, it's like a litmus test for you to see how well you know everybody else in church. Because, you know, if you know everybody else in church well, as you're going through the list, you know, I've been praying for that person, I know that person, I know that person's struggle. But if we're going through the list and you're like, I have no idea who that is, I didn't know that was an issue, like, then that means that the relationships that you have with people in the church are not strong enough, and you need to get to know some people in the church a bit better. Obviously not for the new people that are here, but for those of us who have been going here for a while. So it's, I think it's good that the prayer list is like that. It's sort of is a litmus test to see how well you know each person in the church, and also if you've been praying for them. Okay, we'll sing that song last, and we'll get into the sermon. I'll just pull up my notes. So today I'm going to be preaching on a pretty well-known story. We're going to be talking about David and Bathsheba, and I'll go first to 1 Kings 15. So I know it's probably a very familiar story. I don't know how familiar everybody in this room right now, because I don't know all of you, are familiar with the story of David and Bathsheba, because most people know, you know, he committed adultery, had the husband killed and things like that. So hopefully today's sermon, we're going to read through the passage. We're going to break it up a bit and just get a few principles from the story. And hopefully you'll learn something new today about the story that you didn't know, even though it's a very well-known story. In 1 Kings 15, verse 4 and 5, the interesting thing about this story is it's one of David's really great sins. It's one of the things he did really wrong in his life. And even when in 1 Kings, when his life is summarized at the end, the issue between Bathsheba and Uriah the Hittite is actually mentioned separately. You see here, 1 Kings 15, "Nevertheless, for David's sake, did the Lord his God give him a lamp in Jerusalem to set up his son after him and to establish Jerusalem. Because David did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord and turned not aside from anything that he commanded him all the days of his life." And I personally think when the Bible says things like this, it's alluding to, you know, the fact that, you know, we're saved by grace, we have Christ's righteousness, because obviously David was not perfect. You know, all our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. The Bible says this is why we have to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ to be saved. But look at what it says here. It says he turned not aside from anything that he commanded him all the days of his life, save only in the matter of Uriah the Hittite. So this sort of summary of David's life of, hey, he did all these things great, he was following the Lord, yet there was this one thing that he did, which is the matter of Uriah the Hittite, and that's what we're going to look at today in 2 Samuel. So let's just read, I'll read through the passage quickly from 2 Samuel 11 to 15, and then we'll go over it a bit more in depth and pull out a few principles. So let's read here from 2 Samuel 11. "And it came to pass after the year was expired, at the time when kings go forth to battle, that David sent Joab and his servants with him and all Israel, and they destroyed the children of Ammon and besieged Rabbah. But David tarried still at Jerusalem. And it came to pass in an evening tide that David arose from off his bed and walked upon the roof of the king's house. And from the roof he saw a woman washing herself, and the woman was very beautiful to look upon. And David sent and inquired after the woman, and one said, 'Is not this Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite?' And David sent messengers and took her, and she came in unto him, and he lay with her, for she was purified from her uncleanness, and she returned unto her house. And the woman conceived, and sent and told David, and said, 'I am with child.' And David sent to Joab, saying, 'Send me Uriah the Hittite.' And Joab sent Uriah to David. And when Uriah was come unto him, David demanded of him how Joab did, and how the people did, and how the war prospered. And David said to Uriah, 'Go down to thy house, and wash thy feet.' And Uriah departed out of the king's house, and there followed him a mess of meat from the king. But Uriah slept at the door of the king's house with all the servants of his lord, and went not down to his house. And when they had told David, saying, 'Uriah went not down unto his house,' David said unto Uriah, 'Camest thou not from thy journey? Why then didst thou not go down unto thine house?' And Uriah said unto David, 'The ark and Israel and Judah abide in tents, and my lord Joab and the servants of my lord are encamped in the open fields. Shall I then go into mine house to eat and to drink and to lie with my wife? As thou livest and as thy soul liveth, I will not do this thing.' And David said to Uriah, 'Tarry here today also, and tomorrow I will let thee depart.' So Uriah abode in Jerusalem that day and the morrow. And when David had called him, he did eat and drink before him, and he made him drunk. And at even he went out to lie on his bed with the servants of his Lord, but went not down to his house. And it came to pass in the morning that David wrote a letter to Joab and sent it by the hand of Uriah. And he wrote in the letter, saying, "Set ye Uriah in the forefront of the hottest battle, and retire ye from him, that he may be smitten and die." And it came to pass, when Joab observed the city, that he assigned Uriah unto a place where he knew that valiant men were. And the men of the city went out and fought with Joab, and there fell some of the people of the servants of David, and Uriah the Hittite died also. Then Joab sent and told David all the things concerning the war, and charged the messenger, saying, "When thou hast made an end of telling the matters of the war unto the king, and if so be that the king's wrath arise, and he say unto thee, 'Wherefore approached ye so nigh unto the city when ye did fight?' Knew ye not that they would shoot from the wall, who smote Abimelech the son of Jerubbisheth? Did not a woman cast a piece of a millstone upon him from the wall, that he died in Thebez? Why went ye nigh the wall? Then say thou, 'Thy servant Uriah the Hittite is dead also.'" So the messenger went and came and showed David all that Joab had sent him for. And the messenger said unto David, "Surely the men prevailed against us, and came out unto us into the field, and we were upon them, even unto the entering of the gate. And the shooters shot from off the wall upon thy servants, and some of the king's servants be dead, and thy servant Uriah the Hittite is dead also." Then David said unto the messenger, "Thus shalt thou say unto Joab, 'Let not this thing displease thee, for the sword devoureth one as well as another. Make thy battle more strong against the city, and overthrow it, and encourage thou him.'" And when the wife of Uriah heard that Uriah, her husband, was dead, she mourned for her husband. And when the morning was past, David sent and fetched her to his house, and she became his wife and bare him a son. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. And the Lord sent Nathan unto David, and he came unto him and said unto him, "There were two men in one city, the one rich and the other poor. The rich man had exceeding many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing save one little ewe lamb, which he had brought up and nourished up, and it grew up together with him and with his own and with his children. It did eat of his own meat and drank of his own cup and lay in his bosom, and was unto him as a daughter. And there came a traveller unto the rich man, and he spared to take of his own flock and of his own herd to dress for the wayfaring man that was come unto him, but took the poor man's lamb and dressed it for the man that was come to him. And David's anger was greatly kindled against the man, and he said to Nathan, 'As the Lord liveth, the man that hath done this thing shall surely die. And he shall restore the lamb fourfold, because he did this thing, and because he had no pity.' And Nathan said to David, 'Thou art the man. Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, I anointed thee king over Israel, and I delivered thee out of the hand of Saul, and I gave thee thy master's house and thy master's wives into thy bosom, and gave thee the house of Israel and of Judah. And if that had been too little, I would moreover have given unto thee such and such things. Wherefore hast thou despised the commandment of the Lord to do evil in his sight? Thou hast killed Uriah the Hittite with the sword, and hast taken his wife to be thy wife, and hast slain him with the sword of the children of Ammon. Now therefore the sword shall never depart from thine house, because thou hast despised me and hast taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be thy wife. Thus saith the Lord, behold, I will raise up evil against thee out of thine own house, and I will take thy wives before thine eyes and give them unto thy neighbor, and he shall lie with thy wives in the sight of this son. For thou didst it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel and before the sun." And David said unto Nathan, "I have sinned against the Lord." And Nathan said unto David, "The Lord also hath put away thy sin. Thou shalt not die. Howbeit, because by this deed thou hast given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme, the child also that is born unto thee shall surely die." And Nathan departed unto his house, and the Lord struck the child that Uriah's wife bare unto David, and it was very sick. Let me just get a drink of water. All right, so we just read through that story. I don't know how familiar you are with it or whether you've actually read through it yourself before, but let's just go over it again. Every time I read this story, it's quite gut-wrenching in the sense that David gets himself into this bind and the lengths he goes to cover it up. But let's just go through it a couple of verses at a time, and I'll pull out a couple of things. So verse 1, "It came to pass after the year was expired, at the time when kings go forth to battle, that David sent Joab and his servants with him and all Israel." So we see here that it's a time when David should have actually been fighting in the field, right? He has sent everybody else to go fight, but what is he doing? He's back at Jerusalem tarrying. And often that happens too often with leaders, don't they? Is that they forget what it's like to be in the trenches, and then they send people out to do the work, but they don't actually do the hard yards themselves either. It happens in businesses, it happens in organizations, it happens in churches. It says here, David sent Joab and his servants with him and all Israel, and they destroyed the children of Ammon. And see here, and don't let that, you know, even though that happens out there, whether it's at your job, you know, don't let that give you an excuse to stop working hard, right? So just because the leaders aren't doing what they should be doing, that doesn't mean that gives you an excuse to not serve the Lord. Because look, even though David is in Jerusalem, he's tarrying, he's not fighting with them, but look, they're killing it, right? Like, no pun intended. Like, they're out there, then they're winning the battle, they're fighting hard, they're doing a good job out there. But David tarried still at Jerusalem. And this is where it all starts, right? The problem is that David is idle. You know, they say the idle mind is the devil's play shop, because when a man is idle, that's when he starts looking at things he shouldn't look at. That's when he starts hanging with people he shouldn't hang with. That's when he starts doing things he shouldn't be doing. And the direct application here is fornication and pornography. And it came to pass in an evening tide that David arose from off his bed and walked upon the roof of the king's house. And from the roof he saw a woman washing herself, and the woman was very beautiful to look upon. And David sent and inquired after the woman, and one said, "Is not this Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite?" So we see here that first of all, he's idle, and then he's walking about on the roof of his house. He sees a woman bathing. So, you know, this is the same when it comes to men. You know, and I'm not being hard on men in the sense that, you know, I understand, right? I'm a man, I've been a young man, you know, I have looked at things that I have not should not have looked at. And this is the problem, because when a man is idle, his eyes wander, right? He gets into trouble. And this is why when pornography is ever preached on in a church, when, you know, fornication, not so much, because you actually have to go out and do something. But pornography in our day and age, you don't have to go and try and sneak a magazine anymore at the news agency. You don't have to go out of your way to a strip club to look at pornography. It's right in your home now. You know, it's on the internet. It's in your face. It's almost like you can't even go to a website and read an article without, you know, banners coming up trying to tempt you to go and look at some website where you can watch pornography. And I know how it feels, guys. Like, so I'm not ignorant up here in the sense that, you know, whenever pornography is preached in a church, you know, all the men tend to sort of like cave in a bit, because, you know, we've all done it. You know, we've all looked at things we shouldn't, but we have to realize how shameful it is. And when men start glorifying looking at pornography, you know, sometimes at work, like, men glorify, they joke about how much porn they've got on their computer. They joke about, you know, how much porn this and how much porn that. That's a shameful thing. You know, if men have that sort of attitude, shame on you. You know, do you have no respect for women? Do you have no respect for the things of God, that you will just blatantly look at pornography and have no shame within you? Is your conscience so seared? I hope not. And that's why when we think about the things that we've done, you know, I'm ashamed of the things that I've seen and the things that I've done. So, but what? How do we get away from it? We get away from it by not being idle. And, you know, it's not just a problem for men. You know, women may not so much have the problem of looking at pornography. I know some women do struggle with that. They have the other side of the coin, right, where they want the attention from men. And you see it a lot on social media where women, you know, they take the selfies, they get dressed up, they want to pose a certain way, and they get those likes because, you know, men are liking their photos. You know, they may as well turn that like button into a lust button, because, you know, that's what women do. They get on Facebook and they post, and, you know, sometimes they're half naked or they're showing their cleavage. And you know what I think about that? What I think is, you're just halfway there. You know, because you'd never be like some stripper in a club. You'd never get on, you know, on some website and put pornography of yourself up there. But you're willing to get on social media and basically pose like the prostitutes do, and you're fine with that? And you don't think God has a problem with that? You like making men look at your profile and you know, hit that like button because and follow you? It's the same with like these YouTube channels where you get women and they're just like dressed, you know, immodestly. And you think they've got all the subscribers because people think they've just got something great to say. You know, most of the time they just dressed the wrong way. So women that have that attitude, that dress that way, that men will look at them, I mean, you're halfway there. Do you know, you're halfway to where, you know, the people, the full-on prostitutes are that just men pay to look at. So how do we get out of this problem? Because it's a problem that every man struggles with. And it's it's idleness, isn't it? When a man is not busy working, right, he starts looking at things that he ought not, and he's keeping company with people that he should not. You know, because the equivalent to David's situation here, I mean, he should have been out here fighting, going to war. The equivalent in our day and age is that, you know, you ought to be serving in church. You know, you ought to be getting busy, serving the Lord, going soul winning, you know, working hard at your job, you know, looking after your family, organizing activities, whatever you do, so that you don't get idle, you know, just browsing, you know, YouTube or browsing Facebook and then watching things you shouldn't be watching. And, you know, this is why it's so dangerous. You know, you need to stay busy. You know, idleness is such a dangerous thing, because when you start on the path of being curious, you know that phrase, curiosity killed the cat. You know, when you start getting curious, you start putting yourself in that dangerous situation, it's really hard to stop. You know, and I'm sure, you know, girls may not be able to relate to this, but you guys, girls need to know, hey, this is how guys think, because if you just put yourself out there and you get guys thinking this way, you're going to make your brothers stumble, you know? And this is why idleness is so dangerous, because when you start down that path, it's really hard to stop. Look at David's situation. You know, David's on the roof of his house. He's looking at this woman bathing herself. He sent and inquired after the woman. And one said, is not this Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite? So he even finds out point blank, hey, this woman is married. He's the wife of one of his most valiant captains. You see later on that Uriah is actually named as one of the 37 mighty men of David. I don't know if you know that. So he knows Uriah. You know, when the guy tells him this is Uriah's wife, he knows Uriah, you know, and even though he knows how wrong it is, he still goes ahead with it. David sent messengers and took her, and she came in unto him, and he lay with her. And for she was purified from her uncleanness, and she returned unto her house. So we see here one of the most righteous men in the Bible, a man after God's own heart, even when he put himself in that situation when he was idle, could not refrain himself from going through with it. And that's why it's so dangerous to put yourself in that situation. Let's have a look at 1 Timothy 2, 22. 2 Timothy. Oh my God. This is why the Bible says here, it says, flee also youthful lusts, but follow righteousness, faith, charity, peace with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. So it's, you know, if we have this attitude of men of, you know, hey, I can take it. You know, I mean, I'll put myself in this situation, but I'm spiritual enough to stop. I know when I've gone too far. Who are you kidding? Do you know what I mean? Don't kid yourself, you know? That's why you don't want to be idle. You just don't want to be idle. You don't want to put yourself in that situation. The Bible says to run from it, not test yourself to see like how much you can take before you go through with it. No, you get it. You run away from it and you follow. Look, you replace it with righteousness, faith, charity, peace with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. So you don't do it alone either. You know, that's why it's so important to be involved in church, because then you have people to encourage you to get involved, to serve, so that you don't remain idle. You know, and this is why I don't believe in philosophies that deal with pornography by delving in too deep into it. You know, and you know, I'm preaching against pornography, just to sort of like tell you how bad it is. But the solution is you're not idle. The solution is not that you delve into it and you go and study all the different dark secrets that people study with. And that's out there. Like if you struggle with pornography, the solution is right here. You flee from it and you follow after righteousness. You replace it with not being idle. You get to work. You get busy. You know, the desire that we have to be with a woman ought to drive you to be responsible, to work hard so that you can get married and fulfill that desire, rather than going out and watching a bunch of porno on the internet and satisfying that lust. But if you go to the Christian bookstore, or you go out on the internet and you, I mean, first of all, just be wary of looking up how to deal with pornography if you're on the internet, because chances are people do that, right? And they end up watching pornography, because it's like, you know, it's like the two doors are like right next to each other. It's like Christian pornography books, and then the porn, the hardcore porn on the internet is right next to each other. So, but if you go to the Christian bookstore, right, and you pick up a book on, you know, every man's struggle, or, you know, try and pick up a book to help you figure out how to deal with pornography, generally what it's about is just about people and their struggles. And it's almost like a pornography book in and of itself. And I remember like when I was in youth group and we were talking about pornography and, you know, they're saying, oh, you know, we're going to deal with this and talk about it. I'm like, but I don't want to talk about those things if I'm going to deal with it. If I'm already struggling with lust and pornography, why would I want to delve into it even deeper and just focus on it? No, the way you get away from it is you need to replace it with something else. You need to get distracted from it, right? So that you're not thinking about it, you're busy, you're not idle. And this is the principle that we see here in 2 Timothy 2, that we flee from it. We don't go and study it and look into it. We follow after righteousness, faith, charity, peace. What we ought to be studying is the Word of God, you know, working hard, studying, and keeping busy so that we do not consider and get ourselves in that situation when we are idle. And marriage as well is not the silver bullet. You know, lust is an issue of the heart. And for those of us who are married, we do know. You know, because young people have this false idea that, you know, I'm struggling with lust. Oh, but when I get married, it just disappears. Like, I'm just struggling. And then when I get married, that's going to solve. That's like the silver bullet that just removes all lust. No, because lust is an issue of the heart. And it doesn't matter whether you're married or not. If you do not deal with lust the right way, you know, first of all, you know, you get busy, you're not idle, you're trying to be right with the Lord, you're going to still struggle with it after marriage. Because newsflash, guys, you know, after you've been married with your wife for a while, it becomes common. You know, you get used to that. It's not as exciting as it was when you were chasing the woman. So you need to have your heart right and know how to deal with lust and not just think that marriage is just the cure-all for struggling with it. So we see here the first problem that David had is idleness, isn't he? And because he's idle, he gets into trouble. Let's go back then. Let's go back to 2 Samuel 11 and continue. Verse 5, and the woman conceived and sent and told David and said, I am with child. And David sent to Joab saying, send me Uriah the Hittite. And Joab sent Uriah to David. And when Uriah was come unto him, David demanded of him how Joab did and how the people did and how the war prospered. And David said to Uriah, go down to thy house and wash thy feet. And Uriah departed out of the king's house. And there followed him a mess of meat from the king. So David already is trying to set in place this motion to try and cover it up because he's called Uriah back. Why? Because he's trying to get Uriah. I don't know if you realize what was happening in the story when we read through it. I was just reading through it really quick. But after David finds out that Bathsheba is pregnant, he's like, oh no, he's got to cover it up, right? So what does he do? He sends for Uriah to come back, and now he's trying to get Uriah to sleep with his wife so that Bathsheba can believe that it's his child instead of David's child. So even when he sends him to his home, he sends him with a bunch of gifts as well, like a mess of meat. So it's almost like, you know, he sends him home and sends him like some food and things like that to go home and relax, right? Because then, you know, they don't have to prepare any food, they can spend more time together. But Uriah slept at the door of the king's house with all the servants of his lord and went not down to his house. Now, one thing we see in these passages is just the godly character of Uriah. And it just makes this story all the more painful for Uriah because you realize, man, this guy, he's so godly. He's so committed to David. He's so committed to his captain. He's a hard worker, you know, but you know, and even when David sends him home to try and cover up this sin, Uriah refuses to go back to sleep with his wife. And he sleeps, it says here, at the door of his Lord's house. And when they had told David, saying, Uriah went not down unto his house, David said unto Uriah, camest thou not from thy journey? Why then didst thou not go down unto thine house? And Uriah said unto David, the ark and Israel and Judah abide in tents, and my lord Joab and the servants of my lord are encamped in the open fields. Shall I then go into mine house to eat and to drink and to lie with my wife as thou livest? As thou livest and as thy soul liveth, I will not do this thing. So we find out why Uriah is not willing to go back home. Instead, he sleeps at the king's house because he realizes, hey, my brethren are out in the field risking their lives, fighting hard. Who am I to just take it easy and go back to my house and eat and feast and sleep with my wife? And this is the sort of character we ought to have you know, in the spiritual life. And I mentioned before that, you know, Uriah was one of David's mighty men. I won't go there, but it's in 2 Samuel 23:39 when the 37 mighty men are listed, and Uriah the Hittite is listed in there, not as one of the five really great mighty men, but of one of the 37. But we see here that the type of man that Uriah was, that he wouldn't let his brothers down in war. Uriah, he realized that if he just took it easy when his brothers in battle were fighting, that he would discourage them, right? Because then, you know, he's thinking, you know, I can't do this to them. He realized that his actions, when he went back, if he took it easy, would affect his brothers and sisters in Christ, or his brothers in that case, his brothers out there on the battlefield. And we need to look at this principle and realize in our spiritual life how that affects our brothers and sisters in this spiritual battle. Because when we don't go to war, when we don't take part in the spiritual war, we discourage our brothers and sisters in Christ. You may think your actions are neutral. You think, hey, you know what? I'm just going to come to church every now and then. I'm sort of just off the side. I don't really have any effect. Because, you know, you say, I don't really know anybody. But the fact that you don't get in the fight, you're not fighting with anybody else, you are discouraging other Christians. The fact that you don't do anything. And we even see this principle in Numbers 32. I'll show you here. Numbers 32. I want to show you this story in Numbers 32. And if you're not familiar with it, basically they've come out they came out of Egypt. And if you remember, like the spies went in and then 10 came out, besides Joshua and Caleb saying, oh, you know, the land, they're so big, we're like grasshoppers, and basically discouraged them from going into the promised land. And because they believed the 10 spies, that's why they were made to wander in the wilderness for 40 years. Now that 40 years is over, and now they're ready, the next generation, because that generation that didn't believe died in the wilderness, the next generation is now raised up, and they're about to go into the promised land. They're about to cross the River Jordan, right? And then, you know, there's that great battle at Jericho, you know, and they go around 7 days. So they're at the other side of the river, and what happens is, we'll read here, we'll read the story here. So that's the setting. So they're about to go in the second time, across the River Jordan. Now the children of Reuben and the children of Gad had a very great multitude of cattle. And when they saw the land of Jazer and the land of Gilead, that behold, the place was a place for cattle. So Jazer and Gilead is on the side before crossing the Jordan River. The children of Gad and the children of Reuben came and spake unto Moses and to Eleazar the priest and unto the princes of the congregation, saying, Adaroth and Dibon and Jazer and Nimrah and Heshbon and Eleah and Shebam and Nebo and Beon, even the country which the Lord smote before the congregation of Israel, is a land for cattle, and thy servants have cattle. Wherefore, said they, if we have found grace in thy sight, let this land be given unto thy servants for a possession, and bring us not over Jordan. And Moses said unto the children of Gad and to the children of Reuben, shall your brethren go to war, and shall ye sit here? So Moses' first impression is, because they're about to go into war into the promised land, right? And they're like, they're looking at the land before the river, and they're like, oh man, this land is so good. It's got what's good. We got a lot of cattle. This is good for our cattle. Can we just inherit this rather than inherit over the other side of the river? And Moses' first thought is, are you kidding me? Is everyone going to go to war? And you're just going to sit back and do nothing? He says here, and wherefore, so why, and why discourage ye the heart of the children of Israel from going over into the land which the Lord hath given them? So you see here that there's no neutral ground. If you are not doing things for the Lord, that's why Jesus said, he that gathereth not with me scattereth. Because it's not neutral. If you're not gathering, you're scattering. If you are not in the fight, if you're not out winning the souls, you're discouraging the people that are winning the souls. You know, because... And I preach about this all the time, but just think about it, because we're sheep by nature. You know, whenever there's an event on, you know, and you know, say like, hey, we're going to do this. Most sheep, their first thought is, well, I wonder who else is doing it. You know, isn't that your first thought? When people go soul winning, you're thinking, well, who else is going soul winning? And then when you go there and there's only one other person, what's your first thought? Oh, man, it's really discouraging, isn't it? But if you went soul winning and there's like 10 people rock up, 20 people rock up, that's really encouraging, isn't it? So when you don't get into the fight, you discourage those that are trying to fight. You make it harder for them. You make it easier for the enemy. Thus did your fathers when when I sent them from Kadesh Barnea to see the land. For when they went up unto the valley of Eshcol and saw the land, they discouraged the heart of the children of Israel that they should not go into the land which the Lord had given them. And the Lord's anger was kindled the same time, and he sware, saying, surely none of the men that came up out of Egypt from 20 years old and upward shall see the land which I swear unto Abraham, unto Isaac, and unto Jacob, because they have not wholly followed me, save Caleb the son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, and Joshua the son of Nun, for they have wholly followed the Lord. And the Lord's anger was kindled against Israel, and he made them wander in the wilderness 40 years until all the generation that had done evil in the sight of the Lord was consumed. And behold, ye are risen up in your father's stead, an increase of sinful men to augment yet the fierce anger of the Lord toward Israel. For if ye turn away from after him, he will yet again leave them in the wilderness, and ye shall destroy all this people. And they came near unto him and said, we will build sheepfolds here for our cattle and cities for our little ones. But we ourselves will go ready armed before the children of Israel until we have brought them unto their place, and our little ones shall dwell in the fenced cities because of the inhabitants of the land. So we see here that Moses jumped the gun a little. But Moses realized the seriousness of it, right? When he says, hey, you guys are not going to go to war. You're going to discourage your brethren. And if they get discouraged, we're going to be stuck in the wilderness again, like what happened at Kadesh Barnea. And it's interesting here that just them hinting at the fact that they will not go to war. You know what Moses compares them to? Moses compares them to the 10 spies that came out and actually said, oh man, it's too scary. They're grass, you know, we're like grasshoppers in their sight, actually actively discouraging. Isn't that interesting that Moses, even though these people are not actively discouraged, they're not saying, oh, don't go in. They're just saying, we're not going in with you. But Moses likens that to the 10 spies that went in, spied out the land, came out and actively discouraged people. So you see how there's almost no difference between, you know, whether you actively discourage or whether you just aren't involved. Verse 18, we will not return unto our houses until the children of Israel have inherited every man his inheritance. So this is the right response. They're saying, hey, we want to inherit, we don't want the land over on the other side of the river. We're happy to inherit here, but we will make sure that every man gets his inheritance before we come back and settle with our wives and our children and our cattle. For we will not inherit with them on yonder side Jordan or forward, because our inheritance is fallen to us on this side Jordan eastward. And Moses said unto them, if ye will do this thing, if ye will go armed before the Lord to war, and will go all of you armed over Jordan before the Lord until he had driven out his enemies from before him, and the land be subdued before the Lord, then afterward ye shall return and be guiltless before the Lord and before Israel, and this land shall be your possession before the Lord. But if you will not do so, behold, ye have sinned against the Lord, and be sure your sin will find you out. Now, when I think of this scenario where they're saying, hey, we want to do this, we're going to, you know, spend some time building up, you know, our houses for our wives and children and cattle and whatnot, but we're going to go fight. What Moses is saying here is saying, okay, go ahead then. Go ahead, you know, do what you said you're going to do, build it up and everything. But he's saying, but when the time comes for you to go fight, and you don't fight, you know, he's saying, be sure your sin will find you out. Basically saying, God is going to make sure you don't get away with it. And when I think about that story, I'm trying to sort of apply it to today, like sort of how people do that in the spiritual life, where they say like, oh, you know, yeah, once I finish my studies, then I'm going to serve the Lord. Or, you know, once I get married, then I'm going to serve the Lord. Once my children grow up, then I'm going to serve the Lord. Or once I just, you know, I'm just trying to get this job and I'm just studying hard and whatnot, then I'm going to get more involved and serve the Lord. Or, you know, I'm just trying to get my business together. I'm just going to get it up and running and then I'll go serve the Lord. It's almost like the two tribes that stayed behind saying, hey, they're going to work on some things yet, but when the time comes to fight, are you going to fight? Or is it, are you just using that as an excuse kind of thing where, you know, right now you don't want to go, you're saying you study, working on this, working on that. But then when you actually accomplish it, you know, you finish what you said you were going to do and the time comes to actually go fight, are you going to fight? Whereas the Bible says here, hey, if you do that, hey, mate, your sin will find you out. God sees that. He knows your heart. You know, I don't know your heart. You know, like, that's why I don't give people a hard time if they don't go soul winning and they have reasons not to, or they're not at church, they have reasons not to, because that's between you and God. I don't know. Everyone's life is in different situations, you know, and I understand that some people don't have as much time as others, and some of us have committed to some things and whatnot. We all have our talents and pounds, and we are responsible to God how we are going to spend those. But what I'm trying to say here is God does know. God knows, you know, what you've planned for him, and he knows that you are able to do something and you're not. And if you've made a promise to God, let's say you've said something like, you know what, God, you helped me get this done, and then I'm going to serve you, and then you don't, I don't think God's going to let you get away with it. Just like the guys here, when they said, hey, we're going to build our houses and everything, but when the time comes to fight, we're going to go. But if Moses says here, but if you will not do so, behold, you have sinned against the Lord, and be sure your sin will find you out. So people may have reasons why they delay serving the Lord, but when the time comes to fight, you've got to be ready to fight. And we talked about there being no neutral ground. Let's go back to 2 Samuel. Let's continue. 2 Samuel 11. So Uriah, he understood this principle. He didn't want to discourage his brethren. And this is why, even though David was trying so hard, I mean, even to the point where, we read in that story, even to the point where, remember David got him drunk? He's having a party at his place. He gets him drunk, and Uriah, you know, even though he's getting drunk, obviously that's a sin. But even though he's drunk, he still has that character ingrained into him that even when he's drunk, he still doesn't go back to his house. He still stays at the king's house, at the castle gate, at the castle door, and doesn't go home to his house. David said to Uriah, tarry here today also, tomorrow we'll let thee depart. So Uriah abode in Jerusalem that day and the morrow. When David called, he made him drink before him, made him drunk, and at even he went out to lie on his bed with the servants of his Lord, but went not down to his house. So even when he's drunk, he still doesn't go home to lie with his wife. And it came to pass in the morning that David wrote a letter to Joab and sent it by the hand of Uriah. Now catch that. Have you ever noticed that in this story? That when, you know, so because obviously they don't have email back then, right? So it's not like David can send Joab a text message on the battlefield and tell him what to do. So what he does is he writes a letter to Joab saying, put Uriah in the hottest part of the battle where the valiant men are. Basically, you know, and say when the battle is hot, then pull back, make sure Uriah dies. But what he does is he sends it to Joab by a letter. And you know who delivers that letter? It's Uriah. Can you believe that? That's why this story, like when you realize all the little intricacies of the story, it's so bad. But think about this. Uriah trusts David so much that Uriah doesn't even open the letter. I mean, I don't know how long it takes to get out to the battlefield, right? But, you know, probably most of us, you know, would probably sneak a peek maybe to see what was in that letter that Joab was going to receive. But Uriah, David sends the letter, Uriah's own assassination note or death note, by Uriah. I mean, that's why David is doing some really bad things here. But the trust that Uriah had not to look at the letter, but also the trust that he had in Joab when Joab put him in the heart of the battle, not to question it at all. And it just kind of makes me think, you know, when Uriah died and he went to heaven, I wonder what his first thought was. You know, I mean, I don't know how we're going to think without the flesh, but, you know, would he have been really disappointed? I mean, probably, right? You know, like you trusted so much in David, you trusted so much in Joab, and then you realize that the reason why you died is because your king had slept with your wife and he was getting you killed. Oh, like, man, like it's so bad. All right, let's continue. When he wrote in the letter saying, set ye Uriah in the forefront of the hottest battle and retire ye from him, that he may be smitten and die. And it came to pass when Joab observed the city that he assigned Uriah unto a place where he knew that the valiant men were. And the men of the city went out and fought with Joab. And I'll skip over this for sake of time, but basically he sets him in the hardest part of the battle. Uriah dies. Then he sends a messenger back to David and basically covers his own butt, saying that, well, if David asks you, why did you go so close to the wall? Tell him that Uriah is dead, and then David realizes that's why Joab did it, and that's why David's response is so cold when he just says, well, you know, that's just what happens in war, people just die. One of the things I just thought I'd point out that has nothing to do with David and Bathsheba, but I just thought was a funny, it's just a funny thing in the Bible, I think. I don't know if it's meant to be funny, but I find it funny. It says here in verse 21, it says, when he goes so close to the city wall, who smote Abimelech, the son of Jerubbaal, did not a woman cast a piece of a millstone upon him from the wall that he died in Thebes, why when you nigh to the wall, then say thou thy servant Uriah the Hittite is dead also. If you're not familiar with this story, I just wanted to sort of show you. Where is it? Here we go, Judges 9, verse 50. This story of Abimelech, the son of Jerubbaal, being killed by this woman. This is in Judges 50, and we'll just read these four verses. Then went Abimelech to Thebes and encamped against Thebes and took it. But there was a strong tower. So Abimelech is this wicked king, right? And he's fighting against this tower. But there was a strong tower within the city, and thither fled all the men and women, and all they of the city, and shut it to them, and gat them up to the top of the tower. And Abimelech came unto the tower and fought against it, and went hard unto the door of the tower to burn it with fire. So they're trying to attack this tower, right? And they come up really close, and they're fighting it. Verse 53, and a certain woman cast a piece of a millstone. So this is what's being referred to in 2 Samuel 11, many years later, right? Upon Abimelech's head and all to break his skull. So a woman in the tower throws this rock out of the tower and hits Abimelech in the head, right, to break his skull. And Abimelech's hit. Then he called hastily unto the young men, his armor bearer, and said unto him, draw thy sword and slay me, that men say not of me, a woman slew me. And his young man thrust him through, and he died. So basically this woman casts a stone off the tower, and he's dying. He says to his armor bearer, like, kill me, because I don't want people to say that I was killed by a woman. And what's funny about that is, like, later, like many, many decades later, when King David comes along, they're still referring to that story in battle, saying, why did you go so close to the tower? Didn't you know Abimelech went close, and then he was killed by a woman when she threw the stone? So I think that's just a really funny story in the Bible that, you know, God, it's like God made sure that this evil king, his dying wish was that he wasn't killed by a woman, and he made sure that it was inscribed in the eternal word of God. And even decades later, people are using that as an example of not to go too close to a tower. Now, forefront of the back. Okay, so let's go back. I just thought that was funny. So we see here that David sends this letter to Joab, right? And then Joab does what he's told, puts Uriah in the hottest part of the battle, pulls everyone back, Uriah dies, right? And then David then goes, at the end of the chapter, he goes and sleeps with, takes Bathsheba and his wife and becomes his wife. And then it ends saying that what David did displeased the Lord. Now, one thing I want you to think about is, why didn't anyone confront David when he sent for Bathsheba? Because remember, he sent and inquired for Bathsheba. So he didn't go and get her himself and did it secretly in the night. He sent people to go ask who that woman was. They told him, hey, it's Uriah the Hittite. Then other people went and sent to go bring her to the king. Why didn't anyone stand up to David? Do you know what I mean? Like, why didn't anyone say, like, what are you doing, David? Why are you bringing Uriah's wife into the castle? Like, no, we're like, we're not idiots. We know why you're doing this. Even when he told Joab to kill Uriah, why didn't Joab say no? I'm not gonna purposely put somebody in the heart of the battle so that he died. Like, why didn't he question it? Why didn't he say no? You know, did these people just have this blind loyalty to a man that they no longer were obeying God? And I just kind of think about it in our day and age today, where maybe your boss at work will ask you to do something. And do you love God enough to say no? You know, maybe a mate will ask you to do something, or a family member will ask you to do something. Do you have, you know, the spiritual guts, right, to say no, to stand on what's right, no matter the consequence? Because you know why? You know why people were probably scared to disobey David? Because there were consequences to disobey, right? It's like if you stand up for maybe something at work, maybe you'll lose your job. Maybe you won't be the popular guy at work anymore. Maybe your family won't enjoy your company so much. Whatever the scenario, you make the application in your own life. But you kind of wonder here, why wouldn't people stand up for what's right? And it's often because there's something to lose. And this is why Jesus said, you know, if you're not willing to forsake all you have, you can't be his disciple. Because if you want to follow Jesus, sometimes you're going to have to lose something in order to do that. So just something for you to think about there. Maybe there was too much at stake to do what's right. And are you willing to lose all to make a stand for God? Are you scared? Are you scared for people to find out what you believe? You know what I mean? I don't mean that you just go out there just blazing it to the world. I mean, you'd be wise about how you, because you want people to receive what you have. But if somebody asks you about some of your positions, are you scared to tell them? You know, like I get into conversations all the time at work when people ask me, you know, about vaccinations, about homeschooling, about home birth, about, you know, my religion, about what I believe about homosexuality and whatnot. And I tell them, you know, but I don't just tell them and just say, oh, you know, whatever. You know, I speak the truth in love. I try and make them think. Like sometimes people ask me about certain things that I believe, and I try and get them thinking about why I believe the things that I do. So I kind of like, you know, prepare beforehand, you know, like if somebody ever asked me what are some of the things that I would say. And it's funny, yes, because I've actually been, you know, researching about vaccines. I don't know what you guys think about vaccines, but I'm not for vaccines. You can vaccinate your children if you like, but I am, I'm not for vaccines. I don't think they work. But the illustration I'm just drawing here is Simon cut open his chin yesterday. Sarah pushed him off the stool in the bathroom when he was washing his hand, and he fell on the tiles. If you guys, for those of you who've been to my house, there's those stairs that go up to the bathtub. And I think he basically chinned one of the stairs on that bathtub, and we had to take him for 2 stitches. And so we went to go get his stitches, and then, you know, they always ask you all these questions, you know, the children up to date on the vaccines, and I just tell them, oh, you know, we choose not to vaccinate. And generally they ask you that question because they want the doctor to come in and convince you why you need to vaccinate. But this time I was ready, like, you know, if he was going to ask me, I was ready to talk about it, right? But the thing is, because the doctors are so busy, I just tell you what happened yesterday, because the doctors are so busy, while he's stitching up my son, he's trying to have this back and forth with me about vaccines. And I'm like, well, I don't want to talk to you about vaccines because I want you to concentrate on stitching up my son's chin. But then he wanted to talk about it while he was doing it, because he just wanted to talk while he was stitching and then duck out to the next person. So we didn't end up talking about it. But my point is, I'm not talking about vaccines. My point just is, you know, when I'm at work or whatever, I sort of think about why I believe the things that I do and sort of have little, like, you know, keynotes of what I might say or what I might ask. So that's what you want to get to. You just want to be prepared. You want to be ready, the Bible says, to always give an answer of the reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. So know what you believe. Don't be ignorant. Don't just say, oh, you know, I don't do this because of, you know, I mean, it's true in the sense it might be your religious beliefs, but that's not going to win anybody over, right? Because to them, that's just blind. To them, that's just blind faith. They're just, oh, you just do it because, oh, that's just what you were taught. Not you've actually thought it through and thought about the pros and the cons. You've thought about how it works. You've looked at the science, and then you've decided that that's not the best thing to do. So, how did I even get onto that? What was I talking about again? Standing up for what you believe. That's what I was talking about. So you will stand up for what you believe if you are ready, like the Bible says, to always give an answer. If you are prepared, if you have studied, you will be more bold in what you believe. That's why, like, I don't fear the cops when they come to my house. If somebody reported us for spanking our children, I'm not scared of them coming to my house because I know what the laws are. You know, they can't tell me that it's against the law because I know what the laws are. It's fine to spank your children. So if you know, you're not scared. And it's the same with soul winning. The reason why people are scared of soul winning, why? Because they're worried about what people are going to ask them, right? Obviously, there's the fear, and that fear will never go away of, you know, obviously people rejecting you, like not wanting to talk. You know, that's just part of soul winning, that not everybody is interested. But that's fine. You just move on. But another fear that people have of soul winning is that they don't have the answers. But if you do some study, you think about why you believe the things you do, you'll have boldness from that because you'll have the Word of God in you. You'll know what the Bible says, and you will not be scared to have a conversation with somebody because you know what people can say. All right, let's continue. It's kind of Second Samuel 12. So we're on Second Samuel 12 now. So we see here that, you know, the only person that's willing to confront David, thank God, is Nathan the prophet. And the Lord sent Nathan unto David, and he came unto him. And said unto him, There were two men in the city, and I won't read the passage for sake of time. But basically what happens here is Nathan comes to David and says, gives David an analogy and says, you know, there's a rich man and a poor man. And then this visitor comes into the country, and the rich man wants to put on a feast for him, but instead of taking of his own flock, he takes the ewe lamb from this poor guy to feed the wayfaring passenger. And he basically asks David, what's your judgment, right? And what does David say? David says, well, that person's going to, you know, that person should be put to death and restore the man fourfold. And then what does Nathan say? Nathan says, well, that man is you. You are that man that did that. And every time I read those words where Nathan says, I mean, what boldness Nathan has to go to the king, right? The king, I mean, the king could do anything in these days, right? Nathan goes to him and says, thou art the man. I always get shivers when I read that verse in verse 7, where David's obviously clueless to why this parable is told to him of this rich man and poor man. And he makes this judgment outright, saying, hey, this person should be put to death. And then Nathan tells him, hey, that man is actually you. Imagine what like David must have been thinking, right? Like he's so hard on this judgment. And then he realizes that Nathan is actually talking about him. And then instantly there is some regret there and obviously some repentance. And he realizes that he has done wrong. But a couple of applications that we can get from this is, notice, now the punishment for stealing somebody's animal, right, is to restore fourfold. But what does David say when he gives judgment, right? When he says, hey, this rich man took this ewe lamb, he adds to the judgment. It's not just that he will restore fourfold, but he says, hey, the man will surely die and restore fourfold. So that's not even a just punishment, first of all, right? So David is reacting, overreacting. And what we sort of want to learn from that is sometimes when we judge other people, we're a lot harsher than when we judge ourselves, right? And it's the same when we listen to preaching. You know, maybe you were listening to the preaching today and some of the topics I hit on, and you kind of think, oh yeah, I wish this person was here to hear that. He needed to hear that. You don't really apply it to yourself. It's the same with David. David's hearing this preaching from Nathan. He's coming and telling him about, and Nathan's not thinking about this thing that he just did, where he's taken somebody's wife and killed the guy in battle and then taken his wife to be his wife. He's thinking, oh man, this guy is so evil. Not only does he have to restore fourfold, but he should be put to death. So you see how, like, when we sometimes don't put ourselves first in the situation, we're a lot harsher in our judgment than if we were to reflect first and think, well, wait a second, what if I was in that situation first and then think, hey, what the righteous judgment should be. And that doesn't mean that we just neglect the laws of God, like, for, you know, there are laws in the Old Testament for fines and beatings and capital punishment and whatnot. It's not like saying, well, I don't want to be killed, so therefore don't kill people. It should be, well, if I committed murder, should I be put to death? Yes, so therefore it's not me overreacting if somebody else should be put to death. So, but what I'm saying here is that often we do not apply preaching to ourselves when we hear it, but you ought to apply it to yourself first. If, you know, you ought to remove the beam out of your own eye before you try and remove the mote out of your brother's eye. But sometimes when we don't put ourselves in that situation, we don't judge ourselves first, we are often harsher in our judgment than we should be, and we overstep even the boundaries of God's judgment, like David did in this instance. And, you know, even with preaching, you know, not all preaching has people in mind. Sometimes, you know, you'll preach a sermon or you'll say something in a sermon and people will say, oh, you know, I bet you were saying that for me or whatnot. And there's two things there. Like, one is, you know, preaching obviously has to be a bit broad, and, you know, you preach on certain topics and you might think, oh man, he's hitting on me today, because I don't do that. And that's good for you in the sense that you are applying it to yourself, right? But that doesn't mean when people preach that they're necessarily thinking about individuals. You know, like, we're just preaching the word of God. We're trying to say what we believe is right. And, you know, if you didn't preach things because it's going to upset people, then you wouldn't be able to preach anything, because, you know, people are going to get upset at something in the Bible. So you just sort of focus on preaching what God wants you to preach. You just, like Nathan, he just comes here, he doesn't hold anything back. He just says to David what he has to say. And, you know, then you leave it up to God. You leave it up to the Holy Spirit to work in your hearts if it applies to you. But also you've got to have some compassion on the preacher as well, in the sense that, you know, even for me, obviously I know you guys, I know your situations, and sometimes it is hard to preach things when I know it applies to you. And it, sometimes it's hard when it's like, you know that it's like there's somebody in that situation. And because you know the people in your church, you do think of people sometimes when you preach of things. But it's sometimes that's not usually the reason why, like, you've chosen to preach on a topic. For me anyway, like, I just preach on things that I feel like I haven't preached on or I think would be interesting. And sometimes we hit on things, sometimes I hit on things that might apply to you, but that's just the way it is, you know. You got to apply it to yourself, and hey, that's part of preaching, that's part of the reason, it's part of the nail in the goad to get you moving, to get you to change, so that you'll feel that guilt, you'll feel that conviction, and you'll do something about it. So it also reminds us, you know, when we're hard in our judgment, that we ought to, you know, do unto others as we would have done unto us. Now, other things we see. We see David's, his sincerity. You know, we won't go to Psalm 51, but in your own time, you can read Psalm 51, where David writes a psalm after he's approached by Nathan the prophet. And it shows his sincerity, and he realizes in Psalm 51 that he has sinned against God. Even though he's done something so wrong to Uriah, you know, the child died because of it. He killed Uriah in battle. Now his family, the sword will never depart from his family's house. And that's why there was that the battle that kept going later on down the line. You know, even though David, you know, he realized that even though he had sinned against so many people, that ultimately he had sinned against God. And that's what we have to realize. When we do not do what's right, we ought to realize that we are sinning against God. You know, yes, we do sin against our brothers and sisters in Christ if we fall into sin. We sin against our family. And often people will, you know, if they can't make it to church or they can't make it soul winning or they drop the ball somewhere, they'll apologize to me. And that's fine. You know, yeah, apologize to me. Apologize to people that you've let down. But realize as well that ultimately you have sinned against God. It is God that you have let down. And that is what ought to grieve you the most. Not that you have grieved other people, that you've grieved a God that you ought to love with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. You know, we see here that even though, David was saved, I mean, David is capable, he did these terrible things, right? David was a saved believer, a man after God's own heart, and yet a saved person committed adultery, committed murder, tried to cover up his crimes, did not admit to it, you know, even took the wife after the man had died. So this idea that people have that, hey, if you're saved, you'll just, you know, live right. You won't commit adultery, you won't commit murder, you'll just be this saint because you'll be walking in the Lord, is just false. You know, that's why we never look to our works for assurance of our salvation. I don't know I'm saved because I live a great life, and if you knew me, you know, all my righteousness are as filthy rags. I'm sure, you know, God knows my sin. He knows my thought life. He knows the things that I struggle with. So I'm not going to heaven because I'm a saint. You know, I'm going to heaven because of Jesus. You know, Jesus died on the cross. He rose again. The Bible says if you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you will be saved. That's how I know I'm saved. That's the only reason why I know I'm saved. And we see here that David, you know, even though he was saved, committed some really grievous crimes. So this idea that believers just will not do these things is completely false. And the last thing I sort of want to show you, and we'll end on this point, because I don't want to go too long, but we see here in 2 Samuel 12, "Wherefore hast thou despised the commandment of the Lord, to do evil in his sight? Thou hast killed Uriah the Hittite with the sword, and hast taken his wife to be thy wife, and hast slain him with the sword of the children of Ammon. Now therefore the sword shall never depart from thine house, because thou hast despised me, and hast taken the wife of the Uriah the Hittite." So we see here that even though David was forgiven of the sins that he did, because he was saved, right? So he wouldn't go to hell. It didn't remove the consequences. Right? There were still consequences for his sin. It's the same for us. Even though we're forgiven, even though we'll always be saved, sin has consequences. And if we sin, if we commit fornication, we commit adultery, we do things that are wrong in the eyes of the Lord, there will be consequences. Thus saith the Lord, behold, I will raise up evil against thee out of thine own house, and I will take thy wives from before thine eyes, and give them unto thy neighbor, and he shall lie with thy wives in the sight of this son. For thou did it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel and before the sun. And that ought to scare you. You know, that ought to strike some fear into you, that God, you know, God is a God of justice, and he's a God that chastises his children. You know, God, if an unbeliever does something wrong, their punishment's going to be in hell. But if a believer does something wrong, they're a child of God. God is a loving father. Every son he receives, he chastises. He loves every son. So if children do something wrong, God, as a heavenly father, is going to make sure that child gets chastised. And it's like here, David thought he got away with it, even though he asked for forgiveness, but David's punishment was going to be for all to see, and we have it in the Word of God. Everybody knows what David did wrong. And David said unto Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said unto David, the Lord also hath put away thy sin, thou shalt not die. Howbeit, because by this deed thou hast given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme, the child also that is born unto thee shall surely die. See, so when you sin, you not only do damage to yourself, like David, you know, there's great shame in sinning, and God will make sure that you are punished and chastised through his love. But also we see here that we do damage to the next generation when we sin. When we sin, we hurt others as well. As well as we make it easier for other people to now attack Christianity when we do wrong. And I'll just end on one passage here, but we'll see here in Titus. Let's look at this verse in Titus. It says here, but speak thou the things which become sound doctrine, that the aged men be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith, in charity and patience. The aged women likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness, not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things, that they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. So you see that the things we do, the way we live, if we don't live the way that God wants us to live, we will cause God's enemies to blaspheme the word of God. We'll cause the word of God to be blasphemed. See, when women are not doing what they're called to do, like the Bible says here, to marry, bear children, guide the house, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands. If women are not willing to do that, look at what it says here, that the word of God be not blasphemed. So if they don't do that, people will blaspheme the word of God. Likewise, when older men, if they are not sober, right, grave, temperate, sound in faith, in charity, in patience, the way we act will change how people respond to the word of God, because that's what they see. They don't know necessarily the word of God, but they see how we react to the word of God. And if we are in constant disobedience, if we are in sin, that will cause the enemies of God, like in David's case, he gave them great occasion, and we will give them great occasion if we don't do these things. Not only that, but if we live right, it'll protect our hearts. That's why, you know, one of the armor in the armor of God is the breastplate of righteousness. Have you ever wondered why righteousness is pictured as a breastplate? The reason is because the breastplate, well, this is what I believe anyway, the breastplate protects the chest, which is where your heart is. So when we live right, you know, we do what's right, that's what keeps you right with God, that's what keeps your heart right. And even in David's case, you know, when David was idle, he wasn't doing what's right, his heart wandered, right? And he got into trouble. His heart led him into sin. Whereas if we follow after righteousness, faith, charity, and patience, and the women likewise, right? They have to follow after their things. That will protect our heart. That'll make us put on the righteousness, the breastplate of righteousness, and it'll keep our heart right, and it'll help us in this battle we need to fight. So I hope you learned something. I didn't sort of cover this. There's so much that to cover in this story, but I hope this familiar story came a bit more alive to you as you learn a bit more about it. And next time, you know, you read through it, you'll see those things as well. Maybe learn, the Holy Spirit will teach you some other things. But I hope that was a blessing to you.